Very briefly, I'll introduce you to Timur. Timur was born in Dubna in Russia and obtained his university degree in 2004 from Lomonosov Moscow State University, the physics department, and within the physics department, the neutronography chair. So since 2002, Timur is working as researcher at the Frank Laboratory of Neutron Physics, which is in Dubna as well. And the main facility in this lab is the pulsed neutron reactor. And I emphasize pulsed reactor. There are very few of those in the world. So-called IBR2, which Timur will give you more details about that institution. It has a suite of instruments, around 15, and a very active user program catering for the needs of the Russian community as well as neighboring countries. His current position, he's head of the group of grains. So he's responsible for the program on the grains instrument, which is a neutron reflectometer with horizontal scattering plane. You might imagine why you might want to have a horizontal scattering plane so that your liquid will not fall down due to gravity typically. And he regularly applies both small angle neutron scattering and reflectometry to the problems that he's interested in. Main research interests are related to cluster growth in condensed matter, and in particular, Fullerene solutions, as well as a fair deal of glass transition theory connected to the study of these systems and their modeling, and more recently with also the study of thin films. So without further delay, I will pass the baton to Timur. Please, Timur, if you could share the screen.
Yes. Thank you.
And move on. Thank you, Timur, for accepting the invitation to talk to us today.
Yes. Thank you, Felix, for the introduction. Everything is fine with the presentation?
I see it very well myself.
Okay. So I will begin. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for the invitation to give a seminar at the CFM. We are online, but it's a big pleasure for me. So as Felix already told, I'm Timur Tropin, I come from Dubna. The title of this report will be Neutron Scattering and Complementary Investigations of Fullerene Solutions and Polymer Nanocomposite Thin Films. The outline of the seminar is the following. It consists of the three main parts and the two supplementary parts. I will, after introducing you, some information about the institute and the lab. I will talk about aggregation Fullerene solutions, some general information and structural, kinetic, and theoretical investigations of the cluster growth in these systems. Okay, a little variable section is the glass transition investigation, but for me it is a bridge from the first section to the last one. So I'll talk about glass transition modeling a little bit, and then I'll talk about reflectometry investigations of thin films of polystyrene Fullerene nanocomposites. And some outline of perspectives of this research will be given in the end. So let's begin with the introduction. I was born in Dubna, where the Joint Institute for Nuclear Research is placed. This is a city at the bank of the Volga River. It's a so-called Naukograd, or the scientific city, has 75,000 inhabitants, and it's 100 kilometers north of Moscow. Joint Institute for Nuclear Research is an international intergovernmental organization. It was founded by the decree of United Nations almost 65 years ago. And it consists of 18 member states, which are mostly former Soviet Union countries. And there's also a number of actively participating countries which are listed here, especially Germany, Hungary, Italy, and the Republic of South Africa at present are very active in financial and scientific frame. So our institute has around 5,000 people working in it. So it's quite a large organization, and it has 7 laboratories, each of which is of the size of a large research institute. Initially, the research was only connected with nuclear physics and elementary particle physics. So Dubna, maybe you know, is renowned in the world for discovery and synthesis of the heavy elements. So even one in the periodic table, Dubnium, is named after our town. But as life moves on, of course, such a large organization extends its research field. And so now some of these labs have a program in condensed matter physics, especially this is the case for the Frank Laboratory of Newton Physics, which I work in. It operates around this research facility called the IBER-2. This is a high flux pulsed neutron reactor. It has a unique design with the plutonium oxide active core and two movable reflectors. So these paddles rotate at a very high rate, approximately 10 times per second, generating a series of pulses with a rate of 5 hertz with a very high flux. So this machine is used for research using neutron scattering. Some 10 years ago, the reactor has bypassed modernization. The key elements of the design were replaced, and the fuel was replaced, the reflectors were replaced, the stationary and the movable, et cetera, et cetera. So now, since 2012, it operates regularly. You can take more information on this website. It operates as a common neutron scattering center for the users. So it actually has more than 10 beam lines and more than 15 instruments in all the fields of neutron scattering you would want to have experiments. So you can submit your applications, whether you are from Russia or you are from not from Russia, any application is accepted by the review committee. Okay, my research will be connected with two instruments. The first one is a small angle neutron scattering spectrometer called UMO, and the second one is GRAINS, the neutron reflectometer with the horizontal scattering plane. So these are basically the methods that you would like to use if you want to know the structure of bulk or interfaces by neutron scattering. In case of small angle scattering, you study the structure of bulk and homogeneities in the size from 1 to 100 nanometers. And in case of reflectometry, you do the same, but in the planar geometry, and you study interfaces. In both cases, you have your experiment and you want to reconstruct the scattering length and density distribution in your sample. You're solving some sort of an inverse problem. And because I will have these methods in my work, I think it's sensible to introduce them. And I will start with small angle neutron scattering briefly because it will be used in the next section. The incident beam is scattered and you study the dependence of the intensity on the scattering wave vector. The differential cross section is governed by the scattering amplitude, which is the sum of the waves extending from the point scatterers. In case of neutrons, they scatter at the nuclei. And the empirical parameter here is the scattering lengths of the neutrons on the nuclei. You have these values measured very precisely for the neutrons. And the important fact here is that the dependence of the scattering lengths on the nuclear number is nonlinear. And also a very important fact is the isotopic effect, which is actual for neutrons. So here we have hydrogen and we have deuterium there at the different ends of the values of the scattering lengths. The governing parameter here is also the scattering length density. So you just take the density of your scattering centers in your sample and the contrast between the average density of the particle and the solvent, which determines by part the how well you can measure the data using neutrons. And also you then can substitute hydrogen and deuterium in your sample and highlight different areas. This is called the contrast variation method. Briefly, these are the data you can obtain from small angle neutron scattering measurements. These are different approximation or numerical approaches. In the low angles, the Guignol law allows you to extract the duration radius of your particles. In the whole curve or in the late angles, you can use the Poiret invariant or the Poiret law. Poiret invariant gives you the value of the volume of the particles. If you have a Poiret law, then you can extract the surface area of the particle or the fractal surface dimension of the particles. Again, if you have the slope at a certain range of your scattering vectors, you can take the exponent from it, extract the exponent, and this gives you the fractal dimension of your scatterers in the system. And numerically, you can analyze the whole curve, and if by indirect Fourier transform, you can extract like pair distribution function, which gives you information about the geometry of your scatterers. Or if you have a polydispersed system and you know something about the shape of the particles that are scattered, you can extract the particle size distribution function. In some complex cases, you have multi-level scattering, and okay, by analyzing different parts of your curve or by analyzing it as a whole, you can extract information on the different levels of your particles in the matrix. Now I will transfer to aggregation and Fullerene solutions. So this is a peculiar molecule, and I will talk about its properties in the solvents. We can enumerate different types of solvents that are applicable. So low polar solutions, polar solutions, and water solutions. In these two, there are interesting cluster growth effects with a kinetic character different by the nature. And they are used in some practical applications for obtaining of some systems, and they are also used as precursors for obtaining water Fullerene solutions. So Fullerene is hydrophobic molecule. By using solvent substitution or some very big dilutions, you can obtain stable colloidal water solutions of Fullerene, which are perspective for biomedical applications. For example, I show this picture of a little experiment on mice where synergetic effect of Fullerene solutions with doxorubicin was shown, the suppression of tumor growth by intake of both these drugs was observed. So we were one of the first to apply the investigations of by small angle neutron scattering to these systems, actually. The previous experiments were made by different methods, including DC, DLS, etc. So there was a conclusion that there is a bound water in this Fullerene aggregates in the system. But the amount of this bound water and the existence of this bound water was proven by calorimetry. When you melt and freeze, the melting freezing point is delayed a little bit. But what the structure of the clusters you couldn't answer until you apply small angle scattering. So here are the curves that were measured for two concentrations. The pair distribution functions were extracted, and they were proven to be similar for different concentrations of the sample. And the pair distribution function showed that geometry of this idea is not right, so it was discarded. And further, we wanted to obtain the density of these samples by making the contrast variation experiment by substituting light and heavy water in your liquid. Actually, you can extrapolate the linear dependence and obtain the density of the sample. The conclusion was that colloidal particles consist of densely packed Fullerene molecules, and the amount of conditional component is less than 5%, which led us to choosing the appropriate model of the clusters. Now I will switch to two other types of Fullerene solutions and compare them with each other. So in low polar solvents, you can obtain stable molecular solutions under certain condition. And this is not the case for the polar solvents. In polar solvents, the initial state of molecular solution is at most what you can obtain. It is non-stable, and cluster growth occurs in many cases. In low polar solutions, clusters formation is the result of non-equilibrium preparation conditions. And by now we have some idea that for the general representatives of these systems, it is a result of the photooxidation process. So you shine ambient light or red laser light, you induce photooxidation, and this photooxidation results in the cluster growth. So you can control it in a certain way. In these types of system, cluster formation growth occurs under any conditions and starts even during the dissolution process. In low polar solvents, and in polar solvents, the structure and the sizes of the clusters are also different. I will talk about it just in a moment. And I just don't want to emphasize that the interaction with the solvent is also different. It's weaker here and it's stronger here. Okay, first experiments by small angle neutron scattering were made on low polar solutions in the molecular state. We wanted to attain the molecular state. And actually, the size of the molecule 1 nanometer is at the lowest range of the resolution of the small angle neutron scattering. So it was quite an interesting point to just to find out, can we see these molecules in the solution and how well can we see them? Experiments were done by different groups in different neutron centers. We were measuring in Budapest and in Dubna. So this is a non-equilibriumly prepared solution, and this upshift in the curves reveals that there is some sort of aggregation, and we have extracted the cluster size distribution function showing it consisted of a small part of clusters with sizes more than 10 nanometers and a big part of monomers, dimers, and small clusters. Now, taking upgrades and making more the equilibrium preparation conditions, we found this system. There's no upshift to it, so it's there's no big clusters in the system, but the obtained pair distribution function showed that we still have some discrepancy. It's different from the model approximation of the single Fullerene molecule. There's a bigger size that exists in the system, so there was some investigation, including molecular dynamics, which discarded the solvation shell effect in this system, and the conclusion was that the reason for this type of the pair distance distribution function is the, still the presence of small clusters in the solution. Now, sometime later, quite not long time ago, we have shifted to studying big clusters in these systems that were growing. These experiments were done at the DAISY synchrotron. So this is small angle X-ray scattering. And this is a complex system with several different scatterings, so the small clusters and the large clusters, and fitting it by this function, you can obtain the parameters of these scatterers and show this picture. So now the idea of these aggregates is the following, that the dense Fullerene molecules form dense cluster with a size of 2-3 nanometers composed of 10-20 Fullerene molecules approximately. And then they form by themselves the loose fractal aggregates, relatively loose fractal aggregates with a size of approximately 30 nanometers. And they are composed of tens or hundreds of thousands of Fullerene molecules. And this is not the end of the story. Actually, the dynamic light scattering experiments show that these clusters form larger structures in this case. In this case, we are beyond the resolution of small angle neutron scattering. These clusters are somewhere here in the very small angles. And there's actually no evident reason for them to stop growing, except that they sediment and they're very weakly connected and fall apart in the solution. The kinetics of growth of these clusters was traced by dynamic light scattering. Here is the correlation function. It has two shoulders. This shoulder corresponds to 10 to 100 nanometer clusters. This shoulder corresponds to micrometer size clusters. And the growth of this function with time allows you to trace the kinetics of their growth. It can be easily fitted by the sum of two or three exponential decays, and making them 100 or more measurements per sample, you need to apply automatic fitting that was done. And here is a nice curve that we have obtained for the growth of the hydrodynamic radius in the solution. So after some initial stage of growth, you have diffusion limited type growth, aggregation of the clusters. And of course, you can take other combinations of the parameters. So here, these parameters emphasize the growth of the relative content of the components in the solution. So this is black curves, the growth of 100 nanometer clusters, and these growths of micron-sized clusters. So this is briefly about low polar solutions. Now we can increase dielectric permittivity and move to polar solutions. So they are also applicable as the precursors to obtaining water solutions. And another interesting thing is that in this solution, the transition from molecular solution to a stable colloidal system is similar to the one that we obtain in water if we dissolve it using any of these methods. So this is some sort of a model system. It is interesting also to study. But here is the summary of some investigations. The kinetics of cluster growth are not that easily followed in case of this system because, as I've told you before, it is not easily, the cluster state cannot be easily controlled. And we actually observe cluster growth even once the dissolution process starts. So it's hard to find the initial stages of this growth. So I just show the best picture we have obtained. This is the cluster size distribution function, how it changes with time. You can see that clusters indeed are growing and they're quite large. And there is also observation of some densification that occurs with time. Again, small angle scattering experiments at the synchrotron allowed to gain some additional information on the building units of these large clusters. So the gray one is the fresh solution. The red one is the 1 week old solution and the green one is the 3 weeks old solution. By fitting them, we can extract the average size of the particles that are visible by the small angle scattering. And we see that the size of the clusters increases. And this is related to densification of the building blocks of these larger aggregates. I'm also doing some description of the cluster growth kinetics in these systems, basing on the kinetic theory of nucleation and growth. This is some sort of population balance equations for the cluster size distribution function F. Here N is the size of the cluster in the number of single molecules in it. F is the volume number of these clusters, and T is time. The evolution is governed by the parameters omega plus and omega minus, which define the probability of clusters to grow or decrease in size. And they are defined by the work of cluster formation. And another physical assumption of how clusters grow in your system is attained by taking this omega plus and considering a model of particles travel to the cluster and the rate of attachment to the cluster. So for the diffusion limited aggregation, we have this expression. And it's for probability, of course, falls with time because the amount of free molecules decreases with time. But this basic description is not enough for describing our polar solution. So we came up with a confined growth model where we empirically multiply these probabilities by exponential decay, which reflects the effect of the complex formation in the system. So we hypothesized that complex formation in the system hinders cluster growth, confines cluster growth, and this is in line with experimental observations. And okay, so now we have probabilities decreasing to zero, depending on how big our model parameter is. And this model parameter is the tau time of complex formation, and we want to deduce it from experiments. To do this, we have made some ultraviolet visible spectroscopy light absorption experiments. So in this solution, the temporal solidochromic effect takes place. The typical for molecular solution peak at 330 nanometer decreases with time. And we contribute this decreasing with the formation of complexes in the system and propose the simple model of simultaneous complex formation and dissolution in this solvent. It consists of two equations. K1 and K2 correspond to dissolution and complex formation. And this can be easily solved analytically. And this function can be fitted to the height of the peak, of this peak, and we can extract the rates constant from it for different preparation conditions. That's what we did. So now we had the model parameter for our system, and we could obtain the cluster size distribution functions. I won't go here much into details, but we had to find the master time dependence of the average cluster size and monomer concentration, and it allowed us to compute cluster size distributions for any moment of system's evolution. So here are the early cluster size distribution with small particle sizes, and here are the old cluster size distribution with larger particle sizes. And I just want to show that we can take advantage of this theoretical description to model, for example, small angle scattering curves by taking this integral with the form factor, weighting it by the cluster size distribution function for each moment of time. Here is this intensity of the sun's signal. Here is the average cluster size growing with time. And here is the average intensity of the sun's signal. So what I want to show you is how the small angle scattering picture bypasses a peak when we have good sun signal, and then it goes away. So these calculations allow to, say, envisage the window of opportunity for small angle neutron or X-ray measurements. Another interesting effect in this system is the so-called reorganization effect on the water addition. So if you take a polar solution and add water to it, you do it because you want to have a water cell Fullerene solution. At a certain amount of water added, the cluster, the big clusters tend to decompose and to become small clusters with a size from 30 to 50 nanometers. This is visualized by neutron scattering again. The blue and green curves here are at the background level. This is a solution in neat NMP. But as you add water, the clusters which were situated somewhere here move into the region of the small angle scattering, and you can see them and measure them. This effect actually has a critical character. Cluster state reorganization takes place when amount of added water exceeded 40%. So we wanted to have an idea how to describe this neutron scattering data. And to do that, we took advantage of our previous theoretical description and consider dissolution of our system with water by adding a parameter X, which is the ratio of water added. It is on the interval from 0 to 1. Model of dissolution is we hypothesize that C16MP complexes dissolve in water, which is in line with experiments. They don't sediment from the solution and propose some slow change of diffusion coefficient surface tensions with X. Now, to describe the critical character of this effect, we must answer the key question: how does the solubility of fullerene complexes in NMP water mixture change with X? Okay, linear dependence doesn't work here. We don't obtain this critical character. So we came up with these works in the literature, which showed that NMP, this is a biocompatible solvent, by the way, is planted and is used as a co-solvent for different pharmaceutics. So adding it to water, they non-linearly increase the solubility of pharmaceutics in water. Taking advantage of this notion, we propose the following dependence of the concentration of complexes in mixture in relation to X, solubility in polar solvent and in water. Okay, so we have a model parameter because we don't know what the solubility of these complexes in water is. And this is the general expression that we have used. Now, modeling showed that indeed this dependence explains the character of the effect. So here's dependence of the average side on the X for different values of the model parameter. In most cases, the stepwise change of the decrease of the average cluster size occurs. And by taking the points of this axis on when this effect occurs, we can plot this dependence of X versus model parameter, take the experimental observation that this should occur at 40% of water added, and we can get an estimate of our model parameter. So by adopting this model, we have a prediction of solubility of C16NMP complexes in water. And we can take advantage of the integral I showed you before to calculate the small angle scattering curves and compare them with experiment. This is done here. So this black curve is experiment and blue curve is the model, and they agree quite nicely. Now I will go to the glass transition investigations. This is the research that I'm doing with Dr. Jörn Schmelzer and his colleagues in the Rostock University. So I will not stop on this picture because I have knowledge that at the CFM there is a present and all the older works at the world-class level on the glass transition. So just briefly, when you cool down the liquid, if you manage to bypass crystallization, you enter supercooled liquid range, and finally you enter the glass transition and obtain the glass. It is reflected by the exponential growth of the relaxation time with decreasing temperature. And because it is a dynamic transition, of course, the properties of the system you obtain will depend on the, how fast or how slow you cool down your system. Initial general research was done within the irreversible thermodynamics approach. So the kinetics of system relaxation to equilibrium within a model with one structural parameter are described in this type of equation. We have a structural order parameter and it looks quite simple, but it is very complex because we have a relaxation time here, which is a nonlinear function that depends both on the temperature and nonlinear structural order parameters. So when you solve this equation within a certain general model of a liquid, we use the lattice model of a liquid and system parameters, you have this nice loop of the cooling and heating curve. So black is the equilibrium value of the structure parameter, blue is its cooling value, red its heating value. And of course, applying thermodynamical relations, you can obtain different parameters like entropy production, heat capacity, and others. Our first works were motivated by increase of the possibilities of the calorimetric measurements. So it's not a secret that now the measurements can be made in an exceptionally wide range of cooling rates and heating rates. And so we wanted just to tackle the question of how general models of a liquid glass transition apply to this new experimental situations. And we obtained the dependencies of glass transition temperature and glass transition interval on the cooling rate and cooling and heating rate. Okay, I won't stop much here. we just took two different relaxation laws and obtained the equations in reduced parameters. And also, in some late work, we studied the correlation between the whites of the glass transition and the glass transition temperature. Here's an equation for this correlation and a comparison with measurements for one certain polymer made at a different cooling rates. Other part of this work is connected with differential scanning colorimetry experiments. I'm happy to work with researchers from Professor Christoph Schick's group. They take advantage of a big number of different commercial and state-of-art colorimeters that are there available there, so they can make measurements at more than 10 orders of magnitude rates of cooling rates, and they try to achieve record high cooling rates. I am working on their measurements on polystyrene glass transition. So this is the thermal scheme of this measurement. It has two heating shoulders, which are subtracted one from the other, and the cooling rate is varied. So the value that is obtained is the so-called normalized heat capacity. Here are the different measurements. On each graph, you have a constant heating rate for each for different instrument, and you have a varied cooling rate in a very large range. So normalized heat capacity is convenient to use because it's non-zero only in the glass transition interval and zero otherwise. So the question was, how do the common methods of modeling this data stand against such a wide range of cooling rates? And this work was done within the framework of the tool Nanosfavi-Moynihan model. It is expressed here for the fictive temperature, but I've also tried other models and obtained similar results. So first attempt is to take the relaxation law parameters from the literature, which was measured by many different experimental techniques. And you immediately arrive at discrepancy because as heating rate is much more different from the cooling rate, the discrepancy is very large. And first straightforward idea is to just vary these parameters to attain agreement with experiment. And indeed, you can improve the agreement quite well. But even to attain this type of agreement, as you can see, there is still a discrepancy. But the main drawback of this approach is that you obtain big deviation of relaxation law parameters. So you actually have a different system to model this system. So you have to think about working around this. And the idea was to propose a method to do this by keeping these parameters close or constant to their experimental values. The approach that we are working on now is to vary the value only of two parameters, pre-end exponential time and non-exponentiality parameter. So for each curve, we take a pair of these values. For the red one, it's green one, blue, et cetera, and we take also the values for the reference measurement. And this results in a quite good agreement with experiment. And actually, as a result, we obtain the dependencies of these parameters on the cooling rates. So let's look how they look. So first and good result is that variation of red exponential parameter is not much because we wanted it to be constant. And so the relative change of it is very small and we don't deviate from the relaxation law in this case. The other interesting observation is the monotonous dependence of parameters. For example, non-exponentiality parameter increases with cooling rate. And if you give the work in the Adam Gibbs theory formalism, the same is for tau zero parameter. So this work is continued at the present. Now for the next part is the thin films of polystyrene Fullerene nanocomposites. So as you can see, this system arises as the sort of combination of the previous measurements. I worked with polystyrene and worked a lot with Fullerene nanoparticles. So this is some sort of a model nanocomposite for investigations at present. And we studied in films of it. You dissolve these two materials in toluene and you do spin coating and you obtain a thin film with nanoparticles inside it. And so, of course, you expect nanoparticles to change the properties of your system. And I cite here the work which showed very nicely that the addition of different nanoparticles, including Fullerene C16, enhances thin film stability on the substrate, against higher temperature or higher humidity conditions. So in the end, the dispersion state and structural organization of nanoparticles in the films is very important. And our research was connected with taking the classical Fullerene molecule and taking the other Fullerene molecule C70, which is quite also abundant, but it's not just so symmetric, and to compare how they are structurally organized in the film. This was done by reflectometry measurements, and the neutron reflectometry measurements were done at our grains instrument. So here it's its scheme. It's a multifunctional neutron reflectometer with a horizontal sample plane. And actually it's we have three reflectometers at our lab, and this is the only one with horizontal sample plane. So of course now it's dedicated to the liquid systems and the soft condensed matter systems. That's what we research at the instrument. And research topics are quite wide. A number of different experiments with electrochemical interfaces with liquid electrolytes has been made. And we'll talk about today about polymer thin film structures, layers of metal nanoparticles, magnetic nanoparticles on a substrate from the solution were also investigated. There's a research on lipid bilayers, etc. Reflectometry experiment is quite simple in a specular mode. You have a highly collimated incident beam of neutrons falling on a very flat surface, and you measure the intensity of the reflected beam on a two-dimensional detector. And your curve is the scattering vector depends, scattering wave dependence of the reflectivity, which is the ratio of reflected intensity to the incident intensity. So here's an example of a curve, and your goal is to reconstruct the distribution of the scattering length density and normal to the surface of your sample. Of course, the composition plays a main role. So here I present consecutively more complex systems. If you have two semi-infinite mediums, then this is what you will measure. There's a certain critical wave vector, which is defined by the contrast between your mediums and the neutron wavelengths. Above it, below it, you have a total reflection, which is used in neutron techniques, and below it, you have a Fresnel law of decreasing reflectivity. Now, if you add one layer at the interface, situation changes, and you have equidistant fringes, and you can obtain the size of these fringes, size of your film from these measurements. And if you have a multi-layer structure, okay, you have a complex picture. But in reality, of course, you have roughness of your sample, and so you have something in between these systems, and you want to reconstruct the scattering length density profile. If you have some idea of your system, then you just do the fitting by varying the parameters of your system and adjusting them to fit best your situation. So first we wanted to understand the question, how well can we distinguish different structural organization of nanoparticles in the film? And this to do this, you can just apply some modeling. And this was done by one of the students within his, as a part of his diploma work. He considered different models of structural organization of the particles from his mind and from the literature. So you can take uniform distribution of the nanoparticles, particles forming a dense layer, the substrate, air layer, gradient from the substrate. And he constructed the scattering length density profiles from his models. He had the film thickness, he had the concentration of the nanoparticles. So these nice profiles could be made. Then he could put them into the program and obtain the ideal scattering curve, introduce experimental errors, and then take this curve and try to fit it back to find out, can he find the structure of these smeared curves without knowing what was initially in it. So this was the idea of this work, a different amounts of Fullerene in the part in the film. So the result is this table where the main parameters are the h-square, which is plotted here versus the amount of Fullerenes in the film. Of course, when you have a lot of Fullerenes in the film, you can easily reconstruct the curve, but as the amount decreases, then you'll have problems. So his answer was that at least 1% relative mass content of the nanoparticles must be present in the film for good reflectometry measurements. These are first experiments we were making. We have prepared a set of different films with different fullerenes inside it, with different content of fullerenes inside it, and with different thickness by varying the rotation speed of the spin coater. Here are the example curves measured by the laboratory X-ray reflectometry machine. So these curves can be fitted well. And also I would like to mention that additional AFM measurements were made, and they revealed the presence of some clusters of fullerene. In the film, we have estimated their amount, and further fitting was made of the fullerenes that were not to see what layer is formed by the fullerenes that are not in clusters. So here is the reconstructed profile of the film. And if we subtract the polystyrene scattering length density and the substrate scattering length density accordingly, then the inset shows how the fullerene enriched layer in this system looks like if we have a dense layer at this at the bottom. And this is shows how the fit curves lie on the experimental data. The layer at their interface is discarded immediately. And so we were usually choosing between homogeneous and distribution and dense layer at the substrate. So for these films, more than 60% of the measurements resulted in the existence of a dense fullerene layer at the surface of the substrate. So these numbers in the table show the thickness of this layer in angstroms. And in the parentheses, I show the roughness of this layer. And okay, the final measurements were made by enhancing quality of the films obtained. We took precautions by using our knowledge of fullerene aggregation in solutions to exclude cluster aggregation in the toluene. For some cases, AFM measurements were very nice, showing that indeed clusters are not present. And then we went to to the neutron sketching. Now you can do neutron reflectometry. And made a series of film, mostly for C70 nanoparticles of different content, and the simultaneous measurements, and the two measurements were made, neutron reflectometry and X-ray reflectometry. Okay, so now the thickness of the dense layer was now revealed much better because we simultaneously fitted these curves. And here I show this dependence on the amount of particles added. The stars correspond to C60 molecules, and these lines correspond to C70 molecules. In both cases, for different film thickness, we obtained that the layer is a little bit thicker for C70 nanoparticles. So the main conclusion of this work is, there are two conclusions. First is that C70 also forms a dense layer at the substrate end, and it is a little bit thicker as compared to C60. Okay, instead of concluding, I would just like to show this picture I like very much, is that irreversible processes in condensed matter physics, two of which I was talking about now, are very important. And as the complexity of the system rises, we want to control them more because they in the end govern the structure of the obtained particles. General questions I was talking about now was investigation and consecutive description of these processes, which is the step that is required for control. And I covered some specific questions like high cooling heating rate in the glass transition kinetics or aggregation fullerene solutions. And there's a bunch of unifying examples like nucleation in glass forming systems or polymer nanocomposite in films that I was talking about. And I believe I have shown you a little bit that neutron and X-ray scattering is impacting technique in this field. And as the abilities of neutron methods will increase within a few years, I hope that this impact will also increase. And okay, the final part of my talk, this is just a few slides about perspectives. I will start with the thin films. There are recent measurements, temperature measurements of the of these same films at the grains instrument. Okay, so we increased the temperature going through the glass transition interval. And we want to look how the composition of the film and the structure of the film changes as you go like 30 degrees above TG. There's also a cooperation with Dr. Voloshuk from Adam Mickiewicz University. He's doing some molecular dynamics simulations, and we hope that this will result eventually in comparison of our results. Further work in glass transition ranges, of course, possible. This is formulated within the joint proposal of funding from Russian Federation and DFG, together with colleagues from Rostock University. So we are looking at the fast scanning rates now. I didn't talk about it much, but we already have some nice results showing that the story continues here. The fits with the varying parameters fall into monotonous dependencies, and this must be tackled a little bit more. Also, we want to evaluate some other hypotheses, and this is also made but not concluded at present. For example, I would like to see the temperature dependence of in beta and tau zero to, in the contrary to cooling rate dependence. Of course, the temperature dependence of some material parameter is much more nicer from the physical point of view. And this is motivated by some works in the literature, as I show it here. This is the results of the measurement of beta in the glass transition range and a little bit above it for several gas formers. And you can see it increases. Some general work, generalized expression, work with new data, etc. Okay, other perspectives are of course connected with Fullerene solutions. We are now ready to do some time resolved measurements at the synchrotron to measure the initial stages of growth to see how the structure of these particles changes in polar and low polar solutions. We have the theory and some DLS measurements, so we can hope that the such measurements will be successful. And of course, we will need to update our theoretical description to describe the multi-level cluster growth which we see in these systems. And this work is done together with Professor Pavel Selyshev from South Africa. And so the COVID situation didn't stop IBER2 reactor, fortunately. So back in October, some new measurements were made. I'll just show you the project with Charles University professor Ivan Krakowski. He's making very nice experiments on swelling of hydrogels in surfactant solutions. So this is recent results that we have obtained, and we small angle neutron scattering, and we want plan to proceed with this cooperation further. And this is another experiment on porous carbon samples and porous silica samples together with a colleague from Romania. I come to the end of my report, and what I would like to thank you for attention, and also to thank all the colleagues that are impacting this work together with me.
Thank you, Timur, for a very nice talk. So the floor is open for questions. If anybody has question, let me see. Somebody's raising their hand. Arantxa, hold on, Arantxa, one second. Let me fight through this Zoom system. Allow to talk, okay. Arantxa.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
I can hear you.
Yes, a curiosity. In your science experiments, I saw that the Q value or the Q range is rather limited. As far as I could judge, is about 0.02 reciprocal angstroms. What kind of wavelengths are you using? Is it possible to go to lower Q values than this one?
In what type of measurements?
The first ones you showed with
the water ones.
Fullerene. Yeah. Well. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So There's no sense to go further because this is at the background level here. So I believe these measurements were done at the Geekstadt some time ago. This is quite late work. Yeah, and okay, so the main part of the measurements is here.
Yeah, no, but I mean in next part transparencies, I think it was, you didn't get really the Guinea regime. I mean, the low Q.
Yeah. I see. Yeah. Okay. The low Q values were not attainable in this experiment. I think That's the maximum that was possible.
So which wavelengths are you using?
I think it was somewhere 1 to 10 angstroms.
And you can vary the sample detector distance, or how are you?
At the UMO station, you can vary the sample to detector distance. We actually have two positions of the detector. Yes. So, but in the regime of the cold operation of the moderator, you can actually hope to go to the lower Q values. But in the thermal regime, it's quite hard.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Arantxa. Any other questions? I will mute you now if you don't mind, Arantxa.
Pardon?
I will mute you now.
Yeah.
Thank you. Let's see. There might be somebody else. Let me go. I don't see any more questions. I do have a couple of questions, Timur. The first one is perhaps the opposite of what Arantxa was asking. Have you attempted any total scattering experiments, like the ones you can do at a pulse neutron source? I'm thinking of an instrument like Nimrod in the United Kingdom, where you can, I'm saying that because then you go into the meso-anatomic regimes, and therefore the link to molecular dynamic simulations can be far more straightforward, just to tie.
You mean ultrasound, ultra-wide scattering, yeah?
No, I meant total scattering neutrons, so covering a very wide Q range. So from the low angle regime all the way up to, you could even go up to 10, 20 inverse angstroms.
Okay, and I understand why you want to go to the low angles. Why do you want to go to the wide angles? I mean, to see the single particles, that's not what you really... want. This is what we see in suns. But if you want to go to the lower angles, you can do the ultra small angle neutron scattering.
Yes.
That's a very interesting thing. And actually, we have some recent experiments at MLZ at KWS3 station for C60 in toluene. Yeah. So the pair distribution function can for the larger clusters can be obtained there, and we can study it. Yeah, but this is not processed, so I cannot tie it to the SANS data right now, so I didn't show it. But I think I don't understand why you want to go further here.
Do not worry, Timur. The second question I had, we can discuss it later. The second question I had to do with your colloidal suspensions. I guess that's the best way to think about them. Your liquid C60. Does C70 show any differences relative to C60? You showed some differences in the films, but I didn't see any data on the liquids.
Yeah. So thank you for this question. Actually, I was limited in time, so I just couldn't speak about it much. Aggregation of C70 in neat solvents and in mixtures is a very interesting topic, and actually we have a lot of research in this field, including small angle scattering to compare how they feel in the solution. And of course, the DLS measurements and they show that C70 tends to aggregate too. But the degree of aggregation is different. For example, the clusters are more dense in this sense. Yes, and going to the thin films, there are also some AFM images. They show that C70 forms larger clusters.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but I hope that in the last films we also were able to control it. At least AFM doesn't show traces of very big clusters in the system.
So are the lifetimes of the clusters, or are the lifetimes of the suspensions longer for C60 or for C70?
Lifetimes with respect to sedimentation or?
To stability. Yeah,
okay. So the formation of very large clusters in this system in C70, I believe I didn't observe. So I mean, mesoscopic micrometer clusters, this is the special property of C60 fullerene. Yeah. Uh-huh. And even if you leave it for some time, you will have it, something on the bottom of your vial.
Yes.
It's not the case for C70.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you very much. I don't see any more questions. Please make sure you raise your hand if you have one. If there are no more questions, I would like to thank first Tim Moore for giving the seminar, as well as all attendees for participating. And having said that, I guess we can close the session, and wish you a good weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Timur, if you are,
I'm here.
Are you still there?
Yeah.
All I wanted to, are you familiar with Nimrod at ISIS?
Oh, I've just seen the website now. I didn't make measurements at ISIS because we're not a member.
So, I mean, the magic there, we've done some experiments there, I guess this would be perhaps initially more interesting for the thin films. Getting the entire picture, so you get both small angle and as well you get the mesoscopic range, which is typically hard to bridge with small angle and wide angle diffraction, and also you also go up to very high Qs, so you have a very good handle on sample compositions, scattering cross sections, and so on and so forth. So
yeah, that I understand quite clearly.
Have a molecular dynamic simulation which is getting the interaction between the solvent and your C60 wrong, you will be seeing it in what you would call traditionally the wide angle, which is Qs over one. Okay.
Yeah.
So you will be able to bridge the atomic scale to the mesoscopic and even beyond mesoscopic scale.
Yeah, that I understand clearly, but I don't really see why we need to go to the higher angles. I want, of course, to go to the lower angles very much.
I guess it depends on what really you're trying to answer there. And if you're doing, what sort of, if you're only after cluster sizes, I agree with you. And perhaps you should not be doing neutrons. You should be doing light scattering,
Okay, light scattering has its disadvantages. Okay, yeah,
so X-ray. That was the only reason. I mean, I would maybe encourage you to. There are not many instruments like that in the world, and
I mean, you see, Fullerene is 1 nanometer in size.
Yeah,
you don't need to go in the more Q range. What you want to see there. I mean, what I've showed on the picture, so SANS is enough to see the single fullerene molecules, and that's a methodical result. That's fantastic. And I don't know why we want to go farther.
I think it depends on the question you want to address. If you're trying to, I was coming from the point of view of trying to, you mentioned that you were doing some MD simulations as well, although didn't see much data there. If you're trying to model it on a computer and you're getting your interactions wrong, I really do not know how water actually sits on the surface of C60. Do you know?
No, you can trust always MD results. Yeah.
Can you trust them?
No, you can't trust them on the interactions. you need DFT for interactions. Yes, of course. No, but okay. In water, we have colloidal particles. Yep. So you can't distinguish single particles at all by small cutting. Yeah. Okay.
But the clustering is quite significant, you say.
It's a total cluster state, colloidal state. So we have very nice signal, as it was the question. Yes, by the colleague. Yes, we have very nice signal even for neutrons and even in light water and heavy water, it doesn't matter. But to envisage the interactions, I think you go to spectroscopy. Yeah?
Yep.
So,
Okay, Timur, I mean, thank you very much. And I wish you the best.
Yeah, okay. I hope it was interesting.
Yes, of course. Yeah. And I think, you know, I learned a lot from your presentation.
Yeah, yeah. I was a little bit worried.
A few interesting things that you clearly have a handle on. Thank you.
I was a little bit worried with the time. Yeah. Okay.
No, don't worry. I mean, I think we did quite well. It's 1:03 now, and I think we had plenty of time to talk and plenty of time to do things and ask questions and so on. Okay, Timur, enjoy the weekend.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
My regards to Dorota.
Sure.